Hi, my name is Marc Lucenius, and I'm the lead pastor for Project 938. I had the appointment on my calendar, and I knew it was coming up on Monday, and I was looking forward to it. And I remember thinking about what I wanted to say during this appointment, and I was preparing my mind. I'd go back and forth as to what I was going to say and some of the questions I had. And then the appointment came. I got there and I met my friend. We sat down for breakfast and I just word vomited. I literally backed up my truck, beep, beep, beep. Like the whole thing went up and I just started jumping and dumping. I had ideas and visions. I had problems that needed to be solved. I had strong opinions. And this is just within the first 9 minutes of the conversation, because at that point, the server came and rudely interrupted me and all the things I had to say. This became a heroic moment for me. This person came in and stepped in and was a hero to me, because I talked for an hour or so, and I had so much to say. I had so many thoughts. I had so much on my mind. And when I got it outside of me to somewhere else, no longer were the ideas overly charming to me. No more were the problems overwhelming to me. And my opinions actually just lost a little bite. Maybe they weren't as good as I thought they were. But once I got them out of here into the open, they had less power over me. It was like they got separated from me, and I was a better man that day, and I was a better man that week. That man's willingness to listen to me changed my life for that day and that week. That miracle has happened hundreds, thousands of times for me. Throughout my life, I've had other men and other friends and other people in my life, family members, stop and listen to me. And the act of being listened to has been healing. It's healed me of shame. It's been helpful, and it's given me wisdom that I've needed. It's been encouraging, because it's validated the things that I felt like I was overwhelmed with. It's been encouraging in that when they didn't rescue me, they showed me confidence that I could do it myself. This miracle has happened hundreds, even thousands of times for me, and I hope it has for you as well. Today, we're going to talk about how we can be the people who offer the miracle. We can be the kind of people who listen well. We are in a series that I'm so geeked out about, called What We Can Do. We're living in a situation, you know all about this, we don't have to go back through it, but there's so many things we can't do. We can't go to watch a baseball game. We can't have a party in our home. We can't have church indoors together. There's so many things we can't do. And if we allow ourselves to get swallowed up in the resentment of a world that's just burning with what we can't do, we'll forget about the many, 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 many things we can do. Last week, we had a great message by Josh that I hope helped you throughout the week, where he challenged us to choose joy. When we have trials that are to test us, to strengthen us, to produce character in us. And I hope this week, in the face of your challenges, you get to choose joy. And I encourage you to continue to do that. Today, we are going to be people who know that we can listen. We're studying through the book of James. It's a letter, actually, from the half-brother of Jesus to the early church. These folks were going through all sorts of challenges, and people know it as the wisdom book of the New Testament, because there's so many helpful nuggets in here. And so you're going to hear, I'm going to read the passage to you. We're going to be reading from the second part of chapter 1, and you're going to hear a lot of that wisdom, and we're going to dive right into it. James chapter 1, starting in verse 19. My dear brothers and sisters, take note of this. Everyone should be quick to listen, slow to speak, and slow to become angry. Because human anger does not produce the righteousness that God desires. Therefore, get rid of all the moral filth and the evil that is so prevalent. And humbly accept the word planted in you, which can save you. Now, do not merely listen to the word and so deceive yourselves. Do what it says. Anyone who listens to the word but does not do what it says is like someone who looks at his face in a mirror and, after looking at himself, goes away and immediately forgets what he looks like. But whoever looks intently into the law, and I love this phrase, into the law that gives freedom, and continues in it, not forgetting what they have heard, but doing it, they will be blessed in what they do. Those who consider themselves religious and yet do not keep a tight rein on their tongues deceive themselves, and their religion is worthless. Religion that God our Father accepts as pure and faultless is this: to look after orphans and widows in their distress and to keep oneself from being polluted by the world. All right, I'm going to blow your mind because we're going to talk about listening, and I have 9 points. Yes, 9 points. And I know you're like, dude, can you check the scroll bar, see how long this message is, how long this thing's going to be? Don't worry. We're going to get through this. We're going to get through this together, and we're going to have to go fast fire. So get your pen and paper out. We're going to do this. First thing is this: listening is the first step towards love. It's the first step in any relationship that you want to succeed, any relationship that you want to be healthy, the first step is always listening. If you go to John Gottman and others, they will talk about the science of the brains and of human connection. Daniel Goleman talks about the limbic loop that happens with people, and it begins with being able to empathize with what the other person's experiencing. You can't empathize with what they're experiencing unless you have some basic knowledge of what's going on in their lives. And you can't get that basic knowledge without listening. We learn from marriage experts that, typically speaking, what marriage experts get couples to begin doing to heal a marriage or to restore a marriage is just start talking to each other. Not about the problems, about the simple everyday aspects of life. Because it's in that knowledge that comes the empathy, that comes affection and attention, all the things that make things work. It's fundamental to every relationship. That's the first thing. Listening is the first step to love. And that's what James says. So look, every one of you, and Christians, we should be known by our love. He says every one of you should be quick to listen, slow to speak. All right, that's point number one. Second is this, is that attention is your greatest asset. Think about the phrase, we pay attention. Your attention, yours and mine, is a scarce asset. In fact, it might be your most valuable asset, because if you're going to earn money, you're going to have to pay attention towards something, at least for a certain amount of time to see that it begins earning. Or if you're going to build a relationship, you're going to have to pay attention there. If there's somebody that matters a lot to you, you're going to have to pay attention. Because if you're not paying attention, you won't notice things. And if you don't notice things, you can't care about things. And without noticing, without care, love cannot follow. Physiologically, we know this because babies, beyond just food and sort of drink and milk, we know that they need the attentive gaze of another human face. Physiologically, we need that. Spiritually, we need this. The most famous blessing of the Old Testament, you know how this goes. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. And hear this. The Lord turn his face to you and give you peace. Think about it. When somebody looks at you and listens to you, it communicates a certain value, a certain sense of importance. Well, the blessing of the priesthood upon the people of Israel is that they would know that the face of the Lord is turned to them, that he's listening to them. No joke, the Lord literally put his cell phone down and turns his face to you. And he pays attention to you. He listens to you. Listening is love. Love pays attention. Love puts down the phone. Love steps away from the laptop. Love turns off the TV. Love looks and pays attention. Listening is the first step to the relationships you really want, whether it's your coworkers, your kids, a romantic relationship. Listening is the fundamental first step. Third, listening leads us. It leads us. What ends up happening is it draws us into situations that affect you. If one of the downsides of listening and one of the reasons why we don't listen is because what happens is that listening affects you. One of the things you see in this passage is that he begins, we should be quick to listen, slow to speak, and then talks about even listening to God through his word. And it lands on this. He lands on this idea that, hey, look, if you want to understand true religion is caring for the widows and orphans and those in need. The idea of true religion, true spirituality, means that you're affected by the vulnerable. You listen to the vulnerable. And you're affected by them in such a way that you act for them. True listening creates something in you that causes you to act on their behalf. Now, here's the thing. You know, it's when you're a pastor and you come across certain passages and you're like, you need to teach this. And you're like, I have to teach this? Like, I can barely live this. I mean, you know, I was trying to think about, okay, what would be like a really good, you know, example of how I learn listening? I'm like, well, I mean, there are so many times that I don't get it right. How can I like bundle all of them into one? I mean, as long as the day is long, when it comes to just being a good husband, I just want to like fix her. Or to be a dad, I just want to fix my kids. Because here's the thing, like if they bring me their problems, that means I got problems. But if I can kind of like fix it really quick, like then I don't have to listen to it, experience the problem, right? But what I also know is this, is that as a dad, in particular as a dad, and when I know dads and husbands, one of the things I know is that we have forks in the road when we're going to do the right thing or not do the right thing. And I think, typically speaking, dads have a lot of guilt around, hey, I should have done this thing, I shouldn't have done this thing. But what I know of men, sort of in my circles and the men I run into, they almost always do the right thing when they know the right thing to do. But I think a lot of the struggles of men that I notice is that we cut ourselves off from ever experiencing or being affected by other people. By finding ways to not listen, we find ways for other people to not affect us. Once we're affected, we act on it. Once like our kids are in need, we jump on it. Once our wives, we recognize that they need to be loved or cared for or helped, we jump on it. But we protect ourselves from responding by finding ways to keep whatever the information is over there and not affecting us. That, I think, was a real temptation for a lot of people when the Black Lives Matter protests started in. I think we can agree that there's just some people who just ran out there and just started saying all these things. Like they've got racism figured out, right? The problem that's been with this world since the beginning of humanity, that other people will look down on other people to their own advantage, and they figured racism out. And they're going to give the answer to everybody? I think we know the wise people. They didn't go out on social media and start saying things. They picked up their phone, they texted their friends, and they said, hey, how are you doing with this? They recognized that their friends needed to be listened to. They didn't need words. They didn't need answers. When my wife comes to me and says, you're not treating me well, me pulling out a spreadsheet to show evidence that I am treating her well is just a breakdown of listening and relationship. The wise people I know, in the face of protests and all sorts of drama and all sorts of mess around it, have listened. And we want to be those kind of people as well. All right, number four, listening is a faith metric. And hang in here, God will judge you based upon the way you listen. We need to look at the passage here, and we're like, what the heck are you saying, Mark? He's going to judge me? Yeah. He says, look, if you don't care for people in need, I believe the phrase is right here, your religion is worthless. And he talks about the person who just talks, those who consider themselves religion and do not keep a tight rein on their tongues, they deceive themselves and their religion is worthless. A worthy faith is one that listens to those who are vulnerable and in need and responds to them. This stuck out to me. It stuck out to me when I was, as I was checking out the faith in my college years. During my college years, my mother was sick and she was dying of cancer. And I was participating with, you know, my friends in the college dorm experience. But I had this guy who was different. He wouldn't necessarily go to all the parties. He wouldn't participate in the rest of the parties. But like when people were going through a hard time, they found themselves in his room because he listened to them. And as I started thinking about, okay, what kind of man do I want to be? I want to be the kind of man that people go to and trust to listen. And I remember I had this friend of mine, he would ask me questions all the time, and he would listen to me so well. And I remember I saying to myself, I want to be his friend also, my friend John. And I would literally do this. I would write down four questions. I was going to ask him, and I wouldn't answer any of his questions until he answered some of mine. Why? Because I wanted to learn to be a listener like him. Are you affected by the needs of the vulnerable? Do you allow yourself to be affected by them? Are you bothered by a broken world? Are you bothered by the difficulties in this world and those who hurt? Listening, that's going to bring that into your life. Are you asking God how you can be part of His solution? That was four. Number five is this. Anger is the enemy of attention. If attention is what listening is at its best, that we're listening, offering somebody our attention, anger is the enemy of that. The passage says this. He says, my dear brothers and sisters, everyone should be quick to listen, slow to speak, and slow to become angry. Why? Because human anger does not produce the righteousness that God desires. Anger doesn't get it done. Remember that social media tweet that somebody put up on Facebook? They were so angry and they posted all of their thoughts and they changed a whole bunch of people's minds. Remember that? No, neither do I, because it doesn't work. It doesn't work that way. Anger is the enemy of attention. What happens? They express their anger and people just stop paying attention. Let me start talking about why it's hard for us to listen and pay attention. A lot of times when we think of anger, we think of like Colonel Jessup, you know, from A Few Good Men and his angry face and he's raging and stuff like that. The Bible sees anger in a variety of forms, in bitterness and resentment, in withdrawal and in quietness, in murmuring, in self-pity. Resentment shows up in all sorts of forms. The reason we're angry is because there's a gap. There's a gap. It's a big gap. It's the gap between what we are made for and what we experience in this world. It's not just the gap between what you expected of life and how life has fallen short of it. No, no, no. It's what God made you for and the brokenness that we live with. It's the gap between the just and loving world we are made for and the painful life we and others experience. And what we need to give ourselves grace to acknowledge is that the gap is emotionally demanding. It's emotionally demanding. It's so hard to carry all of it. And it all oftentimes forces us into self-deception. I don't want to see that. I don't want to understand that. Because, well, the truth is, well, we can't handle the truth. Hear what Colonel Jessup has to say about the truth.
You don't have to answer that question.
I'll answer the question. You want answers?
I think I'm entitled.
You want answers?
I want the truth!
You can't handle the truth! Son, we live in a world that has walls, and those walls have to be guarded by men with guns. Who's gonna do it? You? You, Lieutenant Weinberg? I have a greater responsibility than you can possibly fathom. You weep for Santiago and you curse the Marines. You have that luxury. You have the luxury of not knowing what I know, that Santiago's death, while tragic, probably saved lives. And my existence, while grotesque and incomprehensible to you, saves lives. You don't want the truth because deep down in places you don't talk about at parties, you want me on that wall. You need me on that wall. We use words like honor, code, loyalty. We use these words as the backbone of a life spent defending something. You use them as a punchline. I have neither the time nor the inclination to explain myself to a man who rises and sleeps under the blanket of the very freedom that I provide and then questions the manner in which I provide it. I would rather you just said thank you and went on your way.
Colonel Jessup thinks he is entitled to this way of behaving however he wants. Why? Because he says, you have the luxury of not knowing what I know. And the whole movie is built around this idea that, well, there's some folks who can handle the truth and there's some folks who don't. He talks about how deep down in places that you don't like to talk about at parties, we need him on that wall. And that justifies this unrighteous behavior. And you can watch the movie if you want to understand this. But what I think it draws out is that each of us have a difficulty of emotionally handling the gap. The gap really is too wide. It's way more than what we could handle. I've talked about in recent weeks about the fundamental attribution error. And I'm going to repeat it. I keep coming back to it because there's something about our broken humanity that will consistently do this. The fundamental attribution error is when we see somebody else making a mistake, we attribute it to their character. When we see ourselves making a mistake, we attribute it to our circumstances. And that just points to a phrase that comes up twice in this passage that talks about self-deception. What happens to every single one of us is we retell the story around ourselves being the protagonist, ourselves being the victim, ourselves being the hero, and the world being the one against us. We're the one that needs to be vindicated. And it gives us this sense that we don't need to listen to others, but others need to listen to us. And when we do listen to others, we repackage it into something that is more palatable. Something we can work with. And so sometimes we thin slice or we reshape it or we cut down or we try to get it into something that's something we can manage, that's something we could deal with. And we distort the truth we hear, well, to make it just more, a little bit more comfortable for us to receive. Here's a really fun example.
It's just, there's all this pressure, you know? And sometimes it feels like it's right up on me and I can just feel it, like literally feel it in my head, and it's relentless. And I don't know if it's gonna stop. I mean, that's the thing that scares me the most, is that I don't know if it's ever gonna stop.
Yeah. Well, you do have a nail in your head.
It is not about the nail.
Are you sure? Because, I mean, I'll bet if we got that out of there.
Stop trying to fix it.
No, I'm not trying to fix it. I'm just pointing out that maybe the nail is causing—
You always do this. You always try to fix things when what I really need is for you to just listen. No,
see, I don't think that is what you need. I think what you need is to get the nail
out. See, you're not even listening now.
Okay, fine. I will listen. Fine.
It's just, sometimes it's like, there's this achy, I don't know what it is. And I'm not sleeping very well at all. And all my sweaters are snagged. I mean, all of them.
That sounds really hard.
It is. Thank you. Ow!
Oh, come on. Ow. If you would just—
Don't!
Try to see things my way. Do I have to keep on talking till I can go on? We can work it out.
Maybe it's just Stevie Wonder singing the Beatles at the end. I can't watch that enough. There's a couple things going on there that I think is helpful. I think every single one of us can associate with being one. And let's be honest, we've been both of those people over the years, right? We can connect ourselves to both of those things. But here's what I want you to see from a deeper level. I think deep down, we want every problem to be a nail. Because if every problem is a nail, all we need to do is just reach in and pull it out, right? That's what we kind of hope for in life. And when we're listening and when somebody begins talking to us and they show us more of the gap than we need to, or what we start doing, and this is where the self-deception engine starts, we start reforming that thing into a nail. Because if all you got is a hammer, every problem needs to be a nail, right? And so we form it into something that we can fix, that we can address, and listening then fails. Point number six is that anger creates nails. This emotional experience that we have over the gap, what happens is that because of the gap, we find ourselves reshaping the information given to us. And sometimes we can find the right media outlets to reshape it for us, but we reshape the information given us so that we can just swallow it into something that vindicates us and our people and makes it the other person's fault, or something much more simple that we can address. And what happens is we actually lose what's true. And more dangerous, we lose the opportunity for true relationship. Why? Because we're not listening. We're just repackaging stuff into forms that we can have. Let me offer the alternative. Listening without fixing. When you listen to somebody without fixing, it enables the other person to come to terms with and accept the problem. Because if you can accept them and the problem, it helps them to do as well. But also demonstrates trust and confidence in the other person to solve the problem. And then it allows the problem to be, well, maybe it's not a nail, maybe it's a screw. Maybe it's a blender. Maybe it's a rock. Let's the problem be what it is. And that enables us to respond to what it is, not what we want it to be. The truth is, we need the gospel. Number seven is this. The gospel is how we handle the gap. See, in Jesus' death, God has dressed the darkest darkness. He's going all the way to the bottom of the gap. Yet in Jesus' resurrection, he's overcome the greatest gap. He's overcome the darkest darkness and overcome the greatest gap. And because of that, we can trust his ability to address the gap. Because, and men, women, friends, the gap between what this world is and what God designed it for is ultimately his problem to solve. We can't fix that. God has a plan. He's working in it. And if he can address the problem of death, he can address the rest of the gaps as well. We can trust that God is the one on the wall. God is the one who knows the things that we're afraid to know. God is the one who knows the things about your heart that you can't yet know. God is the one who knows your true history. God knows why you are the way you are. God knows why these problems are the way they are in this world. And we can trust his plans. We can trust him to listen. Listening to another is an act of trust in the gospel. It's an act of trust and confidence in the other person, that God can work in the other person. We don't need to fix them. Why? Because God is fully able to fix them. And maybe we'll be affected and we'll be a part of the solution. Sure. But we don't have to be agitated. We don't have to be provoked. We don't have to become anxiety triggered. Because at the end of the day, whatever somebody wants to share with us, whatever we need to listen to, isn't our problem. Does it affect us? Maybe, yes. But at the end of the day, God is sufficient. And by listening well, we proclaim that the problem isn't overwhelming and that God can address it. Number 8 is this. As we learn the gospel for ourselves, we can develop just a way of being that listening is a posture for life. Listen to the way James describes how somebody should be. He's describing how people should interact with the scriptures, and they had mostly pretty much the Old Testament at that time. And he says, look, you should humbly accept the word planted in you. And don't merely listen to the word and so deceive yourselves, but do what it says. This is an important distinction for what it means to be a Christian. A Christian takes their cues from God. A Christian absorbs what God has to say. A Christian is fundamentally listening for what God thinks. And what I challenge you to think about is, how much opinion of the world do you listen to? And how much do you listen to God? How much are you absorbing God's teaching in your life versus what the world might teach you? It says, look, you got to get rid of the moral filth and the evil that is so prevalent. And listen. Listen to God. If you listen to God, you'll be affected by God. But you listen to Him, you become affected by Him, and you experience freedom. It's His word that brings freedom that He talks about. So we have a fun thing we want to invite you to practice a posture of listening for life. Not just listening to God, but listening to others. We have a PDF that we're going to offer to you called Listening Bingo. No joke. Well, it's kind of fun. But we're going to give you the opportunity to try 24 different listening opportunities. We'll give you the one in the middle for free. But if you get a line on those, we'll give you a prize. If you clear the board, we'll give you a prize. But listening is something that we have to practice. And we're going to give you opportunities to practice. Some with your family, some with maybe your neighbors, maybe some with people you don't know. But if anybody should be good listeners, it's the people who have been touched by God, have been touched by God's love, and are led by God's love to pay attention, to notice, to care, be affected, and get involved. Why? Because fundamental to who we are, we're listeners. And let me give you one more reason why. Number 9 is this. Listening is how the world is healed. Let's go to the recovery movement. The recovery movement and the power of the recovery movement is listening. Think about a typical group setting. 6, 8, maybe 12 people, sometimes 30 people together. And what are they doing? They're listening to one another. Just like that man and the men and women who have been heroes to me throughout my life, whether my wife, my friends, whatever, enable me to get what's on the inside to the outside, separate the junk from me and help me to see it from a different light, help me to separate it from it so it doesn't emotionally control me anymore. The power of the recovery movement is listening and not fixing. When anyone comes to recovery movement, they talk about what's going on. They have the support of the people around them. They don't need fixes. We don't need more information. We don't need more information. If we needed more information, we wouldn't have people. We have Google, right? We don't need more information. We need the support to act on that which we already know. And that's the power of the recovery movement. But the reason why the recovery movement is so powerful is because it's a reflection of God Himself. Forever, God has been in relationship with one another. And Jesus now, in His ultimate glorification, is seated in heaven as the ultimate high priest. And what is He doing? He's listening. He's listening. He's listening to you. He's listening to me. In fact, I would suggest this, that He has attached His purposes and the timeline of His purposes in this world upon His listening ear. All throughout the scriptures, almost everywhere Jesus is talking, He continues to talk about prayer. He says, ask and it will be given. Seek and you will find. Knock and the door will be opened to you. He says, look, your God is listening to you. And if you will listen, or you will speak, He is one who is listening and is ready to respond and act and make this world better upon our prayers. God is listening. He's affected by us. He is moved by our vulnerability and by His compassion. He is slow to anger. Man, He's quick to listen. He's abounding in love. He is not afraid of the truth. He knows. And He is overcome. And you are made to be like Him. You are a listener. You are a listener. If you have the very Spirit of God in you, the very Spirit of God is drawn in to the very person of God, which means you have His DNA, you have His character. You just need to walk into it. But and as we walk into it, we bring healing to the world. As we are affected by this world, our prayers go up and Jesus responds. Listening is fundamental to the healing of this world. And we can be a part of it. We can be that kind of listener. Let's do this. Let's pray. Jesus, you've been listening this whole time. And God, I begin by confessing the many, many times that I have tried to fix life on my own, disregarding the one who can heal, the one who can save, the one who can restore, forgetting that you were listening the whole time and everything I needed could be found in you. Jesus, as we see you as one who is listening to us, God, would you make us like you so that with those we care about, those we don't know, and those who need your healing touch in this world, would you give us the grace to listen well? God, would you help us to choose joy this week? Would you help us to listen well this week? Amen.